Dear aspirants, we have two important announcements. Today at 7:30 p.m., Shri T.P. Srinivasan sir will handle the fifth capsule on international relations. The class will premiere on YouTube at 7:30 p.m. This fifth capsule deals with the developments in Myanmar and the implications for India. Given the fact that sir has certain years of experience in Myanmar, he is well positioned to take the aspirants to the related background, history and the recent developments in Myanmar. I humbly request the viewers and aspirants to participate in the class at 7:30 p.m. The next announcement is that tomorrow, that is on 6th February at 7 p.m. in the evening, a class on how to approach essay paper in civil service examination will premiere on YouTube, and the session will be explained by Mr. Satya Krishnan sir, who has secured All India Rank 116 in UPSC Civil Service Exam 2014. He is a renowned expert in approaching essay paper. The session will be explained based on the mains 2020 essay question paper. This class will throw light on how to manage essay questions, the guiding principles for the next year's essay paper, then also on the method of preparation about question selection and other related aspects. He will also detail the difference in the strategy for Section A essay questions and Section B essay questions, and also the skills that matter for securing good marks in essay paper. I humbly request our viewers to attend the class on YouTube at 7 p.m. on Saturday, which is tomorrow, and also to share the information on this class to those who are in need of orientation and guidance for handling essay paper. As you may be already aware, Shankar IAS Academy is launching a special program called Prefit to help the aspirants to effectively use the time available for the upcoming prelims. The free entrance exam for joining this new initiative will be conducted online on 7th of February 2021, that is on coming Sunday. You can take the entrance exam using your mobile phones also, and also you can take the entrance exam while you are at home. The time of test is from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. and the entrance test will have a total of 100 questions. These 100 questions will include questions from both GS as well as CSAT. As we have received numerous requests from various aspirants from many parts of India to waive the fees for the entrance exam, we have made the entrance exam for the Prefit program completely free. So therefore, it will not direct you or take you to the payment section. The only thing you have to do is that you should enroll for the entrance test, and the link for the enrollment is given in the description and also in the comment section. In this program, the academy will provide a micro schedule that is broken into monthly, weekly and daily targets, and the program will provide high intensity interval training for prelims, and this high intensity interval training will not only help you to complete the syllabus but also to enhance your skills in solving questions. The program is modeled on a scientific principle of active recall and spaced repetition to ensure maximum output. The participants will solve around 4,000 questions in the period from February 15 to May 16. In the training, the participants would be given 50 questions on a daily basis for 6 days in a week, and the 50 questions will be based on the study target of that particular day. Each test will be followed by a daily detailed discussion, and once a particular subject area is completed, the daily test will be followed by a full test of 100 questions. By enrolling in this program, you will get a detailed schedule for 3 months, and this schedule will cover both micro as well as macro targets for preparation. And you will be given 5 weekly half tests from Monday to Friday for general studies topics, and as stated already, 1 full revision test will be held thereupon the subject completion. After completion of the syllabus, you will get 4 GS and 4 CSAT mock tests. In order to ensure that the participant should qualify the CSAT paper for sure, the program includes a CSAT test every week, and this test will be of 50 questions. And the program also covers current affairs. This Prefit program divides the current affairs of past 1 year into monthly or weekly and daily targets, and these targets will be covered across multiple tests. Know that this is a totally different program from that of pre-storming prelims test series of Shankar IAS Academy. And if you have already registered in pre-storming and now say you are enrolling in Prefit, then the test under Prefit are in addition to the test taken under pre-storming. The link for the brochure and detailed schedule is given in the description and also in the comment section. Now, how does this Prefit work? See, firstly, our entrance exam will be conducted on 7th of February 2021. The syllabus for the entrance exam is UPSC prelim syllabus for general studies as well as CSAT paper. Those students who secure top 100 ranks in the entrance exam will be eligible for prefit prime. And under this, the top 100 rankers will be given 50% subsidized monthly fee structure. The subsequent months of access to prefit prime will be subject to securing a position in the top 100 in the previous month. Those students who secure a position of prefit prime will also be eligible to avail 25% concession on mainstorming 2021 upon their qualification of prelims 2021. For more details, please visit the links given in the description and also in the comment section. With this, let us now move on to today's news analysis. The list of news articles along with the page number of different editions is given here for your reference. Now let us move on to the first news article. This news article mentions about the number of beneficiaries and fund spent for Pradhan Mantri Matri Vandana Yojana. In this context, let us discuss about the scheme and the news article. The syllabus relevant for this news article is given below for your reference. First, let us understand that in Pradhan Mantri Matri Vandana Yojana, the word Matri in Hindi means mother and Vandana in Sanskrit means worshipping and Yojana means scheme. So, this is a scheme for worshipping the motherhood by providing maternity benefits, or in short, it is a maternity benefit program. This scheme is effective from 2017 and it is implemented in all districts of the country in accordance with the provision of National Food Security Act or NFSA of 2013. And this scheme is implemented using the platform of Anganwadi Services Scheme of Umbrella Integrated Child Development Services, which comes under the Ministry of Women and Child Development. The objectives of this scheme are, firstly, it provides partial compensation for the wage loss during pregnancy in terms of cash incentives so that women can take adequate rest before and after delivery of the first living child. Secondly, it aims for health-seeking behavior among the pregnant women and lactating mothers. See, the idea behind providing this cash incentive is that it would lead to improved health-seeking behavior among both the pregnant women and lactating mothers. So, what is the cash incentive? See, a cash incentive of Rs. 5000 would be provided directly into the account of pregnant women and lactating mothers, and this amount is provided for the first living child of the family. Here, you should note that the incentive is subjected to fulfilling of specific conditions by the beneficiary relating to maternal and child health. And these cash incentives are provided in three installments. In the first installment, an amount of Rs. 1000 is provided on early registration of pregnancy at the Anganwadi center or at an approved health facility. In the second installment, Rs. 2000 is provided after 6 months of pregnancy and it is provided after receiving at least one antenatal checkup or ANC. See, this antenatal checkup is a systematic supervision of pregnant women to monitor the progress of fetal growth and to ascertain well-being of the mother and the fetus. In the third installment, Rs. 2000 is provided after childbirth, that is after childbirth is registered and the child has received the first cycle of vaccines. Vaccines, namely BCG, OPV, DPT and hepatitis B or any other vaccine or its equivalent or substitute. Now here you should note that in addition to this 5000 rupees, beneficiaries would also receive the incentive given under the Janani Suraksha Yojana for institutional delivery and this would be accounted towards maternity benefits. The cash entitlement for different categories of mother under this Janani Suraksha Yojana is given here for your reference. This is provided so that on an average, a woman gets Rs. 6000 as incentives. So you should know why this 6000 rupees. This is because it is mandated by the National Food Security Act of 2013. We saw that the scheme is implemented in accordance with this NFSA, and there is a separate or a special provision in NFSA with respect to the nutritional support to pregnant women and lactating mothers. And here, the Section 4 of the Act, it deals with these schemes framed by the central government for providing nutritional support to pregnant women and lactating mothers. In this, according to Clause B, every pregnant woman and lactating mother shall be entitled to maternity benefit of not less than ₹6,000 in installment. So it is based on this provision only the scheme is being implemented. So now we will see who are all the beneficiaries. See, the beneficiaries include all pregnant women and lactating mother, that is all eligible pregnant women and lactating mother having the first child in the family and who have their pregnancy on or after 1st of January 2017 are eligible under the scheme. But there is an exclusion here, that is those pregnant women and lactating mothers who are in regular employment with the central government or state government or with public sector undertakings, or those who are in receipt of similar benefits under any law for the time being in force are not eligible under the scheme. Also, a beneficiary is eligible to receive benefits under the scheme only once. And here comes a question of what if the pregnancy results in miscarriage or stillbirth. See, in such a case, the beneficiary would be eligible to claim for the remaining installment or installments if they have any future pregnancy. Say, for example, if after receiving the first installment, the beneficiary has got a miscarriage, so then she would be eligible for receiving the second and third installment only if she becomes pregnant again. And this is also subject to the fulfillment of eligibility criterion and conditionalities of the scheme. See, this Pradhan Mantri Matra Vandana Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme. So therefore, the center provides grants in aid to the state governments or union territory administrations in this cost sharing ratio, which is given here for your reference. Now, today's news is that this scheme has crossed the initial estimate of beneficiaries. See, the government initially aimed to reach 51.7 lakh women per year through the scheme. Until financial year 2020, there have been 1.75 crore beneficiaries, and these beneficiaries have received a total sum of 5,931.95 crore. With this, we've come to the end of this news article. Let us move on to the next news article. See this article from editorial page titled A Year On Mind the Gaps in Pandemic Response. So as the title suggests, it's been a year since India detected its first case of COVID-19, and this article written by the former Union Health Secretary analyzes India's response to novel coronavirus and the shortcomings associated with it. So the syllabus for this news article is highlighted below for your reference. Now coming to statistics, India has recorded more than 1 crore cases and more than 1.5 lakh deaths due to COVID-19, and this is the second largest in the world in terms of cases after the US and fourth in terms of deaths. So how India performed in face to face with the world? See, the statistics show that India has performed far better on rates of infections and deaths than many high income countries. Say, for example, India's case fatality ratio, that is deaths for 100 cases, is 1.4% when compared to 2.8% in the UK or 3.1% in South Africa. Whereas India's deaths per million is 112 in comparison to 1,362 in the US and 1,486 in Italy or 1,831 in Belgium. However, it is not done so well when compared to countries of similar income and demography in South Asia. See, while India's case fatalities ratio was lower than Bangladesh and Pakistan, it was significantly higher than Bhutan, Nepal, Maldives and Sri Lanka. And when you take the deaths due to COVID-19 per million population, it was 50 in Bangladesh, 54 in Pakistan and 16 in Sri Lanka, which are lower when compared to 112 in India. So India's performance in terms of cases and deaths is a mixture of both success as well as failure. And in terms of initial response to COVID-19 in India, there were several steps taken early, which includes screening of international travelers, restricting inbound traffic from severely affected countries, and preparing quarantine facilities for those testing positive. So, however, like many other countries, India too has not been able to find a solution till now as to what is the best way to open its borders to normal travelers while keeping out infected passengers. And next comes the question as to how has India performed in terms of lockdown and after lockdown. See, India was also among the few countries to announce a stringent nationwide lockdown much before it had a significant number of cases. See, the UK and the US hesitated to impose a lockdown, and this resulted in the loss of many lives due to their late response. But however, the Indian lockdown was imposed at a very short notice without stating the strategy or specific objectives. Now, first, there was no evidence-based justification provided for such a sudden imposition of the lockdown without any lead time. When India ended up lifting the lockdown, cases were already rising rapidly, with confirmed cases per million people going further from 200 in June 2020 to above 7,000 in January 2021. Unfortunately, during lockdown, there was excessive dependence on security forces in order to ensure the enforcement of physical distancing measures and the quarantine related restrictions. An unintended consequence of the lockdown was a large scale exodus of migrants and families who were forced to walk hundreds of kilometers back to their homes in the countryside, and people died in this exodus, with many in horrific road accidents, and also due to the lack of sufficient food, drinking water, and also because of the stress of traveling. And there, the plight of such migrants highlighted the lack of a social safety net for poor Indians, both from before as well as during the pandemic. So, what we learnt from this pandemic? See, first, in the context of a country's federal structure, no public health response can be successful without the ownership at the state level. And the lack of consultation with state governments saw many of them implementing COVID-19 response policies hesitantly without much initiative or innovation. But this experience has not prompted any rethink of the top-down approach at the national level. Secondly, in all epidemic responses, the generation and use of strategic information plays a very crucial role. So when you take India, India is world famous as a software superpower, and the pandemic would have been an ideal ground for fast-tracking plans to create integrated digital health information system in order to improve the efficiency and transparency of the COVID-19 response. Surprisingly, the Integrated Disease Surveillance Program, which is India's national disease surveillance framework, was not visible throughout the response. Now, coming to Sero Surveillance Survey, which predicts the exposure to COVID-19, the Indian Council of Medical Research, or ICMR, carried out selective studies in metropolitan areas, but these surveys were limited in coverage and periodicity. And it is therefore still a matter of guesswork as to what percentage of India's population have been infected with the virus, which is an indicator of herd immunity. And today's newspaper also reports that 1 in 5 Indians are exposed to novel coronavirus, and this is a prediction made from Sero survey. Then comes the role of the civil society, that is the role of all of us. See, Indian COVID-19 response was marked by a lack of involvement of civil society organization. When you take the example of earlier occasions like polio eradication, AIDS response, civil society played an important preventive and promotional role in bringing the infections under control. And many civil society organizations, they voluntarily stepped into the response, and they played a meaningful role in providing social support and lobbying with funding organizations like the Global Fund for AIDS, Tuberculosis and Malaria in order to provide social support to the affected families. But this time, the role of civil society in COVID-19 response has been very limited. And in recent times, with the development of vaccines and India being in the select group of vaccine producing countries, it can be expected that the pandemic would slow down. And next, following this, comes the problem of reviving the economy and restoring the lives of millions of people who are in danger of starvation and for whom even basic health care has become unaffordable. See, the pandemic period has greatly increased the existing social inequalities. Note, on January 30th, in our economic survey special video, we have discussed how inequalities increased in India, leading to rich becoming more richer and poor becoming more and more poorer. In this context, the new budget has been promising in terms of expansionary fiscal measures which will indirectly support poorer sections of the society. And further, there is an urgent need to examine all these critical gaps in the response to the pandemic, whether they occurred through acts of omission or commission. And without such an open inquiry and widespread debate, India will miss another chance to learn the right lessons and to ensure a more robust, well thought out and humane response to similar crises in future. With this, we have come to the end of this news discussion. Let us see what the next news article deals with. This article says that the Tamil Nadu governor has refrained from taking a call on a plea for the early release of Rajiv Gandhi assassination case convict AG Perarivalan. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the case and then about Article 72 and Article 161. We know that a former Prime Minister Sri Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated by a suicide bomber in the year 1991 in Chennai during an election rally. And in the year 1998, all accused were awarded death sentence, and later the Tamil Nadu government recommended for the remission of sentence for a convict, which has been put up on hold at different levels since then. Now, in this context, let us see about Article 72, which is about the power of President to grant pardons and to suspend, remit or commute sentences in certain cases. See, the president is empowered to grant pardons to persons who have been tried or convicted if the punishment or sentence for an offence that is against a union law, or where the punishment is by a court martial, and when the sentence is a sentence of death. See, this pardoning power of the president is an executive power which is independent of the judiciary, and the president, while exercising this power, does not sit as a court of appeal. And this provision will keep the door open for correcting any judicial orders in the operation of law, and also it will afford relief from a sentence which the president regards as unduly harsh. Know that the pardoning power of the president includes pardon, commutation, remission, respite and reprieve. When you take pardon, it removes both the sentence and the conviction, and it completely and absolves the convict from all sentences, punishments and disqualification. And commutation, when you take, commutation is the substitution of one form of punishment with a lighter form. Similarly, remission means reducing the period of sentence without changing its character. And when you take respite denotes awarding a lesser sentence in place of one originally awarded due to some special fact, like for instance the physical disability of a convict. And when you take reprieve, it implies a stay of the execution of a sentence, especially that of death, for a temporary period of time. Like Article 72, which deals with the power of president to grant pardons and to suspend, remit or commute sentences in certain cases, Article 161 deals with the pardoning power of governor. So we shall know that the pardoning power of the governor and president are different in certain aspects. See, while the president can pardon sentences inflicted by court martial, the governor cannot. And also, the president can pardon death sentence while the governor cannot. And even if a state law prescribes death sentence, then the power to grant pardon will lie only with the president and not with the governor. But the governor can suspend, remit, or commute a death sentence. So therefore, both governor and president have concurrent power in respect of suspension, remission, and commutation of death sentence. So with this information, let us move on to the next news article. This article elaborates on the recent budget proposal. See, the Union Budget of 2021, it was proposed that the interest on any contribution above rupees 2.5 lakh by an employee to a recognized provident fund is taxable. So, in this context, let us discuss in brief about the EPFO, its important schemes and other related aspects. The syllabus covered by this article is given below for your reference. Now, let us move on to the news article. See, the article says that in 2018 to 2019 alone, more than 1.23 lakh high net worth individuals had deposited more than 62,500 crore into their employees' provident fund accounts. And also, the largest EPF account has got a huge 103 crore balance. So, it is clear that a small group of HNIs or high net worth individuals were misusing this welfare facility as a source for tax-free income. Now, let us see about the employees' provident fund organization. See, this Employees Provident Fund, it came into existence with the promulgation of the Employees Provident Funds Ordinance in the year 1951, and this was later replaced by the EPF Act of 1952. And it is now referred as the Employees Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1952. See, the act and schemes framed thereunder are administered by a tripartite board known as the Central Board of Trustees, Employees Provident Fund. And this board consists of representatives of both central and state governments, employers and employees. And it administers a contributory provident fund, pension scheme and an insurance scheme for the workforce engaged in the organized sector in India. The board is assisted by the Employees Provident Fund Organization, which is also called as EPFO, which consists of offices at 135 locations across the country. The EPFO is under the administrative control of the Ministry of Labour and Employment, and know that EPFO is one of the world's largest social security organization in terms of clientele and also as per the volume of financial transactions undertaken. According to a 2016 to 2017 report, EPFO maintains 19.34 crore accounts pertaining to its member. And you note that the board operates three schemes, which includes the Employees Provident Fund Scheme of 1952, which is also called as EPF, then the Employees Pension Scheme or EPS of 1995, and the Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme or EDLI of 1976. Now, coming to the benefits of EPF scheme, it provides for accumulation plus interest upon retirement, resignation or death, and also partial withdrawals are allowed for specific purposes like house construction, higher education, marriage, illness, etc. The EPS offers monthly benefits for superannuation or retirement, for disability, for survivor, for widow or widower, or for children. And in this case, the amount of pension is based on average salary during the preceding 12 months from the date of exit and total years of employment. It also offers a minimum pension on disablement. Now, coming to the EDLI scheme, or the Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme, it provides benefits in case of death of an employee who was a member of the scheme at the time of the death. And according to revised scheme, the payment of benefit amount is 20 times the wages, or it is based on the deposit in the provident amount, whichever is less. Finally, let us discuss about the Universal Account Number or the UAN number that is offered by the EPFO. See, the idea behind this UAN number is to link multiple member identification numbers or member ID allotted to a single member under a single UAN, and this UAN will help the member to view details of all the member IDs linked to it. Now, suppose a member is already allotted UAN, then he or she just has to provide the same on joining new establishment. So, this will enable the employer to mark the new allotted member identification number to the already allotted UAN. So, therefore, the main objective behind this new function is to capture the KYC details of its members in order to eliminate the dependency on the employer and to improve the quality of service. So, with this, we have come to the end of discussion of this particular topic. So, let's move on to the next topic. This news article mentions that the Ministry of Corporate Affairs plans to decriminalize Limited Liability Partnership Act of 2008. See, this Limited Liability Partnership Act aims to make provisions for the formation and regulation of the limited liability partnerships and its related matters. So, let's see what exactly is a limited liability partnership. See, as per Section 3 of the Limited Liability Partnership Act, a limited liability partnership is a body corporate and a legal entity which is separate from its partners. It is a corporate business vehicle which enables professional expertise and entrepreneurial initiative to combine and operate in a flexible, innovative and efficient manner. See, this LLP is a form of alternative corporate business that gives the benefit of limited liability of a company. See, this limited liability means it is a condition by which shareholders are legally responsible for the debts of a company, but they are responsible only to the extent of the nominal value of their shares, which means that the liability will not exceed the amount invested by that partner in a partnership. Further, no partner is liable on account of the independent or unauthorized actions of other partners. Thus, individual partners are shielded from the joint liability created by another partner's wrongful business decisions or misconduct. Also, this LLP is a separate legal entity. So, therefore, it is liable to the full extent of its assets, but the liability of the partners is only limited to their agreed contribution in the LLP. The LLP also gives the benefit of flexibility of a partnership, because LLP can continue its existence irrespective of changes in partners, and also it is capable of entering into contracts and holding property in its own name. The LLP is called a hybrid between a company and a partnership because it contains elements of both a corporate structure as well as a partnership firm structure. Coming next, the LLP Act has got certain provisions that makes the criminal liability to be mandatory for the violations of certain provisions, and the criminal liability arises when a person commits an act which is criminal in nature. Say, for example, as per Section 7 of the Act, every LLP shall have at least 2 designated partners who are individuals, and at least one of them should be a resident of India. See, if this section is violated, then as per Section 10, the LLP and its every partner shall be punishable with fine, and the fine can range from ₹10,000 to ₹5 lakh. In addition to this, the Act has also got provisions which provides imprisonment as punishment. That is, if any person makes a false statement at the time of incorporation of LLP, then he or she shall be punishable with imprisonment for up to 2 years. Or any person carrying a business of LLP with the intent to defraud or for any fraudulent purposes, etc., is also punishable with imprisonment. So, now at present, the government wants to remove the fear of criminal prosecutions from non-substantive minor and procedural omissions and commissions in the normal course of their business transactions. And also it wants to provide greater ease of doing business for law-abiding LLPs. So therefore it has decided to initiate the process of decriminalization of compoundable offences under the Act. See here, compounding means forbearance or refraining from the prosecution as a result of an amicable settlement between the parties. So those offences which could be compounded are going to be decriminalized. See, the main objective of this move is to remove criminality of offences from business laws where malafide intentions are not involved, and as a result, the government is proposed for the decriminalization of 12 offences under the Act. So, let's take up this prelims question. Consider the following schemes. The first scheme is Janani Suraksha Yojana. Then it is Janani Sishu Suraksha Karyakaram, and then it is the Pradhan Mantri Matra Vandana Yojana. So it says, which of the above schemes provide cash incentives to pregnant women? So when you take the first statement or the first scheme, that is Janani Suraksha Yojana, it is a safe motherhood intervention under the National Health Mission, and it is being implemented with the objective of reducing maternal and neonatal mortality by promoting institutional delivery among poor pregnant women. And the scheme was launched in the year 2005, and it is a centrally sponsored scheme which integrates cash assistance with delivery and post-delivery care. When you take the second one, that is the Janani Sishu Suraksha Karyakaram, which was a scheme launched in the year 2011 in order to assure free services to all pregnant and sick neonates to access the public health institutions. So rather than providing cash incentives, the scheme aims to provide free and cashless services to pregnant women for normal deliveries and cesarean operations, and also for the treatment of sick newborns up to 30 days after birth. So as seen in the discussion, the Pradhan Mantri Matra Vandana Yojana, it provides for a cash incentive of ₹5,000 into the account of the pregnant women and lactating mothers. And here you should know that it provides for the first living child of the family, and also the incentive is subject to fulfilling of specific conditions by the beneficiary relating to maternal and child health. So therefore, the right option is option B, that is 1 and 3, because only JSY and PMMVY provides cash incentives, whereas when you take the second option, that is JSSK, it provides free and cashless services to pregnant women instead of providing cash incentives. So therefore the right option is option B, that is 1 and 3 only. Now moving on to the next prelims question about the pardoning powers, it says, with reference to the pardoning powers of the president and the governor, consider the following statements. So the first statement, it says, only president and not governor can pardon sentences inflicted by court martial. Second one, both president and governor can pardon a death sentence if it is prescribed under the state law. And the question asks us to identify the incorrect statement. See, as seen in the discussion, the president can pardon sentences that are inflicted by court martial, but the governor cannot do it, and also the president can pardon death sentence while the government cannot. So therefore, option or the statement 1 is correct, because only president and not the governor can pardon sentences inflicted by court martial. Coming to statement 2, see, the president can pardon death sentence while governor cannot, and even if a state law prescribes the death sentence, the power to grant pardon to it lies only with the president and not with the governor. So, but here, since the statement says that both president and governor can pardon a death sentence, it is incorrect. So, therefore, the right option is B, that is 2 only, since the question asks to identify the incorrect statement. So, let's take up this prelims question related to LLP. It says, consider the following statements with reference to limited liability partnership. First statement is, it is a body corporate and a legal entity separate from its partner. Second one, it has the benefit of flexibility of a partnership. And option 3, in an LLP, partners are liable to the full extent of its asset. So, the question asks to identify the correct statement. See, when you look at statement 1 as seen in the discussion, statement 1 is correct as the limited liability partnership is a body corporate and it is a legal entity which separate from its partners. Coming to statement 2, it is also correct because LLP gives the benefit of flexibility of a partnership because LLP can continue its existence irrespective of changes in partners. Now, when you look at the third statement, which says in an LLP, partners are liable to the full extent of its assets, the statement is found to be incorrect because LLP gives the benefit of limited liability of a company. See, limited liability is a condition by which shareholders are legally responsible for the debts of a company, but they are responsible only to the extent of the nominal value of their assets, which means the liability will not exceed the amount invested by that partner in a partnership. And further, no partner is liable on account of the independent or unauthorized actions of other partners. So, therefore, the individual partners are shielded from the joint liability created by another partner's wrongful business decisions or misconduct. So, therefore, since the question asks us to identify the correct statement, the correct option is option C, that is 1 and 2 only, because options 3 is incorrect. Let us take up this prelims practice question about the employer's provident fund. So, the question says, consider the following statements. The first statement is, it is a tripartite board with representatives from both central and state governments, employers and employees. And statement 2 says, it comes under the administrative control of the Ministry of Finance. So, with reference to the Central Board of Trustees of the Employers Provident Fund, which of the statements given above is or are correct? So, when you look at statement 1, as seen in the discussion, the Central Board of Trustees is a tripartite board which consists of representatives of both central and state government, employers and employees, and it administers a contributory provident fund, the pension scheme and an insurance scheme for the workforce engaged in the organized sector of India. So, therefore, statement 1 is correct. And when you look at statement 2, it says that the employees provident fund, it comes under the administrative control of the Ministry of Finance. But what we saw in the discussion is that it comes under the Ministry of Labour and Employment. So, therefore, this statement is wrong since it does not come under the control of the Ministry of Finance, but rather it comes under the control of the Ministry of Labour and Employment. So, therefore, the right option is option A, that is 1 only. Now, look at this mains question, which says, in containing COVID-19, India has fared better than many higher income countries, but fell short when compared to countries of similar income and demography in South Asia. Analyze. Write your answer for this mains question and upload it in the comment box. Dear aspirants, a gentle reminder, kindly stay tuned for another 2 hours for the 5th capsule on international relations by Shri T.P. Srinivasan sir. With this, we have come to the end of this news analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, share and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more information regarding UPSC Civil Service preparation.